Good evening, everyone. Time for episode 9 of the Drums of Doom, part 2 of the Duaredheim Staff Saga. By me. We're going to start on page 101 of the chapter entitled Linea. Okay. Right where we left off. Linea. It was a great, sprawling city, surrounded on all sides by a mighty wall. Outside the gates, the city had outgrown its ancient defenses, and many roads and burrows had risen up there. Vendors and their carts were scattered along the roads, selling their wares. Sales clerks greeted them without a hint of suspicion. "Good sirs," they would say, "would you like some fine cheese or a bottle of wine or other such things?" And to avoid unwanted attention, they would sometimes stop to purchase a little of this or of that. Several miles of vendors, twisting streets, and general traffic passed before they came to the main gates of the city. Tremendously thick and almost impenetrable, they stood wide open with only a few bored soldiers protecting them. A guard approached them. "What business do you men have in the city?" "We've come to visit family," Olak said. "And how long will you gentlemen be staying?"
"Oh, we shouldn't be more than a day or two, sir."
"Your names, my lords?" the guard asked.
"Beric and Darius Mornbend, of Three Rivers Ford," Draco answered.
Jotting their names in his logbook, he waved them forward. "Just be sure to check out with us before you leave, good sirs. Enjoy your stay."
"Thank you."
They then rode into the main city proper, and it was even more densely populated and chaotic than the village outside of the walls.
"Where do we find the brothel?" Draco asked.
"We'll have to be discreet. We can't afford to attract any attention. Our manner of dress seems perfect," Draco noticed. "We should be fine as long as we lay low. Let's just ride around for a while and see what the city is like." Ride they did, traveling down as many streets and alleyways as possible without getting lost. Overrun with soldiers and constables, the roads of Linea and its citizens seemed guarded and on edge. The laws here appeared to be quite strict. In the afternoon, three constables arrested a young man for spitting in the street. Shackled and hauled brutally away by them, he begged for mercy but received none. All this happening while a prostitute stood at a nearby street corner, promiscuously flaunting her wares. "Maybe we should be more careful still."
"Agreed. It seems to be a very strange place indeed."
"Let's find an inn with a good stable and find out what we can." Asking around, they soon found a fine place called the Blind Waiter. Leaving their horses with the groom, they paid him a few small coins and entered the tavern. Porters even helped them with their packs. "Are you hungry, my lords?" the hostess asked. "You're just in time for supper."
"Yes, my lady," Olak said. "That would be wonderful."
It was a full house, but she seated them quickly at a small table. Around them, people of all ages, shapes, and sizes supped. Dinner was an excellent meal of roast mutton, cornbread, boiled squash, and a dessert of custard. In no time at all, they were both stuffed and quite content. Their waitress seemed friendly, even bubbly, and seemed likely to be aware of their nobility.
"My lady, we're new in town, and we were wondering if you might have some advice for people who need to go out and about."
"Oh, it's a good city, my lords. You just have to know the rules and stay away from the high priests, if you don't mind my saying so."
"Oh, no," Draco said, "not at all. Perhaps when you have time, you wouldn't mind telling us about the rules."
"Well, I just don't think that it's my place, my lords."
"Oh, nonsense," Draco said.
"Well, I do get off in about a half of an hour. I could help you then if you're still here."
"We'll make sure of it."
They waited and overheard a few conversations that were very enlightening. It seemed that the local king was a puppet of the church. They worshipped a sun god named Lu, ruling everyone, believers or otherwise, with ruthlessness, whips, and cruelty. They tolerated no other religions, enacting a new set of laws to better control the people. The most strictly enforced rule was a mandatory curfew, permitting no travel between midnight and dawn, except under the direst emergency. The second and most dire law was the forbidding of worship of any god save the sun god. Open worship of any other deity was punishable by death, and the priests were quite eager to enact such punishment. The most popular form of execution was decollation in the town square by a professional headsman. Some time later, the young lady returned, dressed for the road. "My lords, I have a little time if you still would like my help." "Please do sit down," Olak said. "Can we order you anything?" Draco asked. "No, thank you, my lords." "Well, we must do away with my lords at once," Draco said, "and offer you our names. I'm Beric Mornbend, and this is my brother Darius. We've come from Three Rivers Ford." "Well, sirs, I have heard of that, but it's a long way off, isn't it?" "Yes, it is quite a journey." "My name is Adeline, but everyone just calls me Addy." "Well, Addy, we had just arrived in town yesterday when we noticed a man getting carried off for spitting in the road. It seemed a little harsh." "Yes, you have to be careful these days. It wasn't always that way, though." "Oh, when did the new laws go into effect?" "Well, up until a year ago, our good king, King James the VII, kept things running smoothly and very justly. But he suddenly became very religious and joined the cult of the sun god. Some say that the high priest cast a spell on him that made him that way." "That's too bad. What should we look out for?" "Well, there's the whole spitting thing, and no riding horses on Thor's days, and definitely don't get caught drinking ale on a Frey's day after 4 in the afternoon." "Can you think of anything else?" "Oh, God, yes," she said excitedly. "Definitely don't get caught letting your horses drink from the public fountain, and above all else, don't let anyone see you carrying a sword or dagger inside of the city. Only the constables are allowed to go around armed." "Well, that is quite a list." "Oh my, Lord Beric, I am just getting started." "Let me see. Oh, there is no displaying of holy symbols other than the sun god's golden orb. Church service on Sun and Dog is mandatory for the whole city, and public displays of affection are completely illegal and punishable by public flogging." "Well, is that it?" "Yes, I think that's about it." "Thank you, Adeline," Olak said. "That was splendid. Could we get you anything?" "Oh no, my lords, it's been a pleasure. I hope that I've been some help." "You have no idea." "Well then, I'll be taking my leave. I have to go home and take care of my daughter." "Good night, Adeline. Good night." "Well, I guess we should be turning in before they come out with any more laws. Tomorrow is Saturn's day. We need to find Christoff soon." "Yes, I'd rather not have to bow down to this sun god and his priests." Saturn's day dawned bright and crisp. The city was a little bit slower than it had been the previous morning, and the two disguised noblemen rode leisurely through the streets. Luck was with them, for a lady of apparent ill repute was on her way home from somewhere. "Excuse me, madam," Olak said. "May we have a word with you?" "Sorry, lads, but I'd best be getting home." "We'll make it worth your while. I can offer a gold coin for some simple information." "Well, I'll be hearing your question first." "Of course." And after a brief discourse, they had an address and the lady had her gold coin. 3 blocks down, they turned right and trotted to the end of the alley. There they found a plain city door with a small sign. It had a crystal slipper attached to it. An iron hitching post in the shape of a horse's head stood a few yards to the left of it. Dismounting, they tethered their horses there and approached the door. They knocked upon it, 4 times fast and 2 times slow, as the lady had told them to. A small window slid open, and a lone bulging eye ogled them. "Who be there, and for what do you come?" "A young lady told us that this was the place for entertainment if you are gentlemen with money." "So it is, so it is," the voice croaked. "Place your weapons in the slot to the left of the door, and I'll let you enter." "We have no weapons." "Come now, my friends. My spell of detection has revealed many blades well hidden. If you're after what you claim, then you'll have no need of them." Foul odors seemed to pass through the door or around it, assailing their nostrils. Looking at one another, they shrugged. Removing all their hidden weapons took quite a while, and the bulging eye seemed to widen ever more. The hairpins, too, the eye said. I see great danger in the two of you. I assure you that our need is genuine, Draco said. We are friends of the Madame Mater D. Is that so? Then I know that you are dangerous indeed. I'll allow you to enter into the first chamber only. It will be up to the Madame to let you further in. The door opened and the butler hovered before them. Huge and round, several eye stalks writhed atop his head. His enormous central eye never lifted its gaze from them. He spoke through a crooked, tooth-filled maw at the base of his body. Right this way, gentlemen, he said, all the while chewing upon the remains of an amputated arm dangling from his mouth. Still partially covered in flesh, it soon disappeared. Forgive me, friends. Our last customer received services that he couldn't pay for. It cost him an arm and a leg. His laughter then echoed throughout the parlor. Get it? An arm, he crunched. And a leg? Yes, sir, Oleg said. We get it. He led them through a short, narrow hallway. They came to a waiting room, with a front desk and a long burgundy curtain behind it. Well-upholstered chairs lined the wall opposite the main desk. A brass-hinged door stood closed to the right of the desk. The madam will meet you shortly. Please make yourselves comfortable. Shortly thereafter, the door opened. Hello, gentlemen. When I heard that friends of mine had come here to visit, I just leaped out of bed. I barely had time to do my hair and makeup. Madam Minx, the butler said, these two young men say that they know you. Oh, but I don't believe that we have ever met. Walking behind the desk, he caressed the curtain. Clearly a man, yet disguised cleverly as a woman, he was obviously a queen of another sort. Fine-featured, he was slim yet muscular. Wearing a long blue evening dress complete with ruffled sleeves, a padded bra, and a tight corset. A fine black wig adorned his head. A little too much rosy red makeup disguised his face. Somehow, he had learned to walk skillfully in heels. We know each other through a mutual friend, Draco said. Oh, and is it regarding business or pleasure? Madame Minx has something for everyone's tastes, that is, if you have the gold. Alas, for our last customer did not. We've come to see you about business of a more serious nature. Madame Minx then moved nonchalantly to face them, his hands hidden beneath the counter. This wouldn't be pertaining to the sheriff's taxes, because I just paid him in full yesterday. No, madam. This pertains to private business of a more global nature, and I can assure you that we mean you no harm. Perhaps if we could speak more privately, Draco said, then we could better explain ourselves. My butler and I are well acquainted, and I keep no secrets. Whatever you might say will not surprise him. Well then, Olak said, we've come to hire Christoff, the assassin. If only he were here, Madame Minx said. He left town just yesterday. He said that he was retiring. I doubt that one such as Christoff would ever retire. Well, I'm sorry, but he isn't here. Would he be here for the promise of great riches? He said that he doesn't work for mere money anymore. He's got that aplenty. What if the job was the most dangerous and challenging that he'd ever faced? It would have to be very challenging indeed. Our mutual friend requests the capture of one of the kings of the mountain dwarves. They are a noble race, Madame Minx said. Why would he want to capture him? He needs him as a hostage to ensure payment from his son. Such a capture would be both perilous and challenging, but I cannot see a just cause in it. I will require further payment, such as the two of you must help me finish your job here first. They then spoke long into the afternoon, and by evening they had reached a fair compromise and agreed upon it. They would exchange one noble cause for one perilous challenge. That night, the high priests of the sun god died in their sleep, and the king escaped from their evil sorcery. The next day, The people of Linea returned to their old temples and begged their true gods for forgiveness. The good King James the VII soon repealed all his recent decrees and returned the laws to normal, that is, except for the drinking of ale after 4 o'clock in the evenings on Fridays. The reason for this, he said, was that he received too many complaints from wives whose husbands never made it home on time. That night, the king ordered a grand celebration, decreeing that every year from that day forth, the city would celebrate Freedom Day. There was much rejoicing. Olak and Draco then began their journey toward the far eastern shores of Firminor, to a small kingdom called Safe Haven, ruled by a noble king named Lord Cherrick. Traveling in the guise of wine merchants, they practiced their new roles until they were second nature. Christoff purchased a large wagon to house their wares, and its covered interior concealed his faithful butler. It was a front that they practiced in every city and village along their way, and they had soon collected many exotic brews and fine wines. They lacked only one major brew, the champion Kegporter ale of the dwarves. Their fabled wine was legendary as well, never served unless it had aged at least 100 years. Their road would take them across hundreds of miles of roads, fields, and lonely campsites, and finally arrive through the mountains into the heart of a volcano, and then their collection would be complete. How Christoff captured Moldrin, chief of the Kegporter clan. They supped in the quiet town of Waysboro. Merchants were commonplace here, and they blended in like trees in the forest. The bartender was happy to give them directions to the kingdom of the mountain dwarves. "Follow the northwest road," he said. "Cross the great fields, and it will lead you into the Dark Kragan. Stay on the trail, and you will find their kingdom." Journeying into the evening, they came to a great lake with waters as black as coal. "Let's camp here," Christoff said. "It seems to be as safe of a place as any." "Lord Cherrick seems to keep his kingdom both peaceful and lively," Draco said. "Seems a shame that we must bring war here." "They control valuable seaports, and their land is fertile. But most of all, I think that our queen fears that we will someday want such things for ourselves as individuals. Don't we?" "Of course, and that is why we follow Vlad, in the hopes that we may bring about a new Dragonian order. The Furmen who have interfered with Vlad's plans come from this region." "But why this, Dwarven Chief?" "He is the father of the dwarf the orcs call Argordok, a revenant spirit they fear above all things. Therefore, Vlad needs to neutralize him," Draco said. "Why not just confront this dwarf ourselves?" Christoff said. "It may come to that, but Vlad has a plan, and he values the lives under his command." "Then we must succeed for him," Draco said. "Oh, we will," Christoff said. They haven't encountered enemies like us in 1,000 years. They survive by mining and trade. They will allow us into their kingdom with open arms." "Is there no risk, then?" "On the contrary, we'll have to find a way to see the father of the dwarves personally. And that will require the greatest tact. The slightest insult could get us expelled at the least. He's sure to have a retinue with him." "No doubt he'll come with an escort. I expect 2-to-1 odds at least, but I have a plan. Several, actually. Such as, once we set up our first business meeting, we must wait for the opportune moment." They made camp then, and it was peaceful and refreshing. Yet for these men, accustomed to constant danger, it was almost too quiet. "How do you sleep?" Draco asked. "Almost not at all," Olak said. "It's just too quiet," Christoff agreed. "We'll sleep better once we enter the mountains. There's lots more danger there." Breaking camp, they left quietly and leisurely in case any watching eyes might grow suspicious. Their wagon rolled along the well-grooved road smoothly, its merchant driver whistling a happy tune. The two nobles riding alongside of him were obviously at ease in the saddle, cavalier and confident. They rode as if they passed through their own land, a place where danger never dared to tread. 2 days' ride, and they would arrive at the home of the mountain dwarves, the direct descendants of Baldric, first king of Dwarvencrest and father of all the dwarves. The diary of Olak Tempestus describes their uneventful journey, but is not chronicled here. His detailed description of Christoph's plans portrayed his growing respect for the assassin and his hopes for the future. Lord Min's Fortress Under the Volcano. News traveled quickly through the honeycomb of tunnels that made up the halls of the mountain dwarves. A wealthy merchant from the far reaches of the continent had arrived, requesting a challenge of brews between the brewmaster of Kegporter Ale and the most traveled wine merchant in the world, Master Johann Christie of Linea. No one had dared to do such a thing in centuries, and to say that it caused a stir beneath the mountain would be like calling a volcanic eruption a mere disturbance. Impossible! Lord Min raved. No brew in the world can match that of Moldrin, nor of any keg porter, for that matter. There's no way that we can accept such a ridiculous challenge. But my lord, said his adviser, such a refusal might be seen as a weakness among the other races of the world. They don't understand the importance of our craft, or the honor and respect that we place in it. The king muttered to himself. That does complicate things. Summon Moldrin and all the chiefs at once. We'll let the council decide. What should we do with the visitors, my lord? Just how many merchants have come here? It's not even the peak season. There are three of them, my lord, but I believe that only this Christie is the leader. Sit them down to supper with the outer wall company, the king said. They'll teach them the hospitality of the dwarves. Laughing with his adviser, he soon turned serious once again. Summon the other chiefs. Bring me Kegporter, Anvilhead, O'Baldrick, and Hammerhune. We will decide together if this Christie gets a challenge. It took the rest of the evening to bring all the nearby chiefs together. They were leaders of all the major clans living in and around the kingdom, but there were a great many more clans hidden in remote, far distant places all over the globe. Nevertheless, here, along the eastern shores of Firminor, there was only one known settlement, the kingdom of Lord Min under the volcano. Their ancient legends tell of their origins of their first great realm, which they called Dwarvencrest. Sadly, in ages past, there was a great upheaval, and so, over time, even the dwarves forgot where they had originally migrated from, or why, and the grand citadel that once was now only a nearly forgotten dream. Nevertheless, they were still a proud, talented people, peerless in their crafts, although from time to time someone might have the audacity to challenge them. Moldrin, the king said, what say you to this challenge? What claims does this challenger make? Mr. Christie claims that among his many brews from across the globe, at least one will rival the mushroom ale of the mountain dwarves. Ha! Preposterous! Unforgivable! Such a thing is insane beyond knowing, and yet I will accept any such challenge. If only to prove once again that Kegporter ale is the smoothest, least bitter, and most refreshing, an incredibly gratifying drink in the entire world. But this human cannot be serious, the great Anvilhead said. Either he's a lunatic, or his mind has been filled with nonsense. He must be a fool. Then perhaps, Lord Min said, we should prove his foolishness once and for all. I have another fear, old Baldrick, the most suspicious of the chiefs said, that these men have some hidden agenda, and that his challenge is something sinister. Perhaps they wish to see our inner halls, and in so doing, find some weakness for an attack of some kind. Yes, the king said. There have been many strange happenings in the last few months, including the loss of my son to the orcs. Maybe this Christie is a Dragonian spy. It is wise to be careful, Moldrin said, but I think that this matter is just what it seems, a challenge of brews. We have had them before, although only twice before in my lifetime. Then do we vote to allow this challenge, the king said, and under what conditions? We shall have the consent. We shall have the contest in the great council hall, Chief Anvil had suggested. And under the watch of 1,000 armored dwarves, Chief O'Baldrick added.
I also suggest that we invite neutral parties from amongst our most trusted friends in safe haven, said Chief Hammerhewn. The king drummed his fingers and pondered. The sons of Lord Cherrick, then. And his second daughter, Molly, the chief added. It is said that of all the fair women in the kingdom, she is the fairest in judging a contest. Then she shall make the final ruling, so that no one can doubt that we brew the finest ale, Lord Min said. Let us be careful and let us be true. The hearts of the dwarves are strong. Let us finally settle the mystery of whose brew is finest. We are all in agreement, then. Aye, they all said. Then let each clan send 200 strong, and let the horn sound out that all who wish to witness the challenge shall be allowed into the hall as long as there is room enough. When shall the challenge be? 3 days hence, Lord Min decreed, when the sun sits highest in the sky and everyone is seated and comfortable. Let the royal chefs prepare a feast. Let us show our 3 guests the hospitality of the dwarves these next few nights. I have a feeling that this will become the event of the century. Dwarven hospitality. 2 nights of hearty food and great quantities of ale had left the wine merchants light-headed at best. Their plans had spun wildly out of their control, and they were now at the mercy of fate and of their hosts. The dwarves had made certain that their reputation as powerful drinkers was unquestionable, and Olak and his companions had no choice but to try to stand with the best of them. In the end, their dwarven friends carried them back to their quarters. Carved from solid rock, their rooms were well furnished and comfortable. Untold hours passed before they were again conscious enough to speak about their predicament. "Well, Christy," Draco said, "what plans do you have for us now?" "We must go through with the contest," he said. "We can't avoid it. We'll lose, and then they'll throw us out." "Of course we'll lose, but the brews that I have collected will challenge them, and the spirit of the contest will win their trust. We just have to take our time." "What then?" Olak said. "We'll be surrounded by an army of dwarves." "Apex will be our secret weapon," Christoff said. "Listen closely, and I'll tell you all about my plan." And that's where we'll end episode 9. And we'll begin episode 10 on page 116 with the chapter entitled The Great Council Hall. And we'll see how the Brewmaster's Challenge progresses. I hope you enjoyed today's reading. And as always, read The Drums of Doom, Part 2, followed by The Last Admiral, Part 3. And the newly available Ice Moon, Part 4 of the Duaredheim Staff Saga, which concludes the epic series. Thank you and have a great night.